I don't know anyone's feelings about the abortion debate, but I will say that I am pro-abortion, but then I found out that I was born in 1972, a year before Roe v. Wade, and suddenly my thoughts about abortion were a little bit on the fence there.
I think intelligence is overrated.
Where it all started was, I don't know anyone's feelings about the abortion debate, but I will say that I am pro-abortion, but then I found out that I was born in 1972, a year before Roe v. Wade, and suddenly my thoughts about abortion were a little bit on the fence there. But basically, so I was adopted when I was a young boy, and my mother actually went and took my adoptive mother to court about 6 months later, and she tried to get me back. She fought for me in court. It went through the system. It went all the way to State Supreme Court, New York State Supreme Court, and they ruled in 5-4 in favor of my adoptive mom. And so this is something that was always in the back of my mind, and when my daughter was born, I decided to start looking for my parents. It really was something that really made me start thinking about that. And so I went and I found my mother. I was 25 years old, and I found my mom, and she just happened to be best friends with Bobby Chouinard's wife, Bobby Chouinard, the drummer from Billy Squire. And so he was like, "Oh, you play drums, that's really cool." I said, "Yeah, man." We became really close. He became a mentor of mine. And then my mother couldn't handle the fact that she had given me up. This was a big source of contention, and she felt guilty and all this stuff, and she came to me and she said, "I can't deal with this." And she left. She left me again for a second time. I was devastated, needless to say. And I went to Bobby Chouinard and I said, "Bobby, my mom left." And he told me, "You still got me, kid." And he became a great mentor of mine, and my love for drumming, I mean, I've been drumming for a long time, but my drumming really went to the next level with him kind of under his wing, taking me under his wing, and really giving me great advice. And this was right before I joined Banana Fish, and Bobby had passed away about a year before that, and I had done actually 5 auditions for 5 other bands, and Banana Fish was one of the bands that I had answered some ads in Village Voice. And I walk into the room, it was a cold audition, and the first song that they played was Sassafras. And if you know Sassafras, it sounds a lot like Everybody Wants You by Billy Squire. And I always felt like that Bobby Chouinard was on my shoulder looking over me. Because when I walked into that room, sat behind that drum set, and they started playing Sassafras, I was like, "Oh my God, this is Everybody Wants You by Billy Squire." It wasn't, but the guitar opening, the way it sounds, you would think that it was the same song. And I was like, "Yo, I got this gig. I got this gig. This is my fucking gig." And they were like, "Oh, we're not sure. Here's a CD. Go home." And then next week I came back. And now I had gotten the pink record. I learned the pink record. I came in. Later on, I had found out that I think either John liked me or Hal didn't like me after the first audition. Then the second audition, I came back with the CD. Now I had done my homework. I played. I thought I did really well. And then I found out later on that actually they had flip-flopped. That by the second audition, then John didn't like me and Hal liked me. And they still were on the fence. Now, when, you know, they kept going back and forth.
Were they with somebody else? Were there any other contenders against you?
I have no idea.
The drummer that they were trying to get rid of?
Yeah, or? I think they were auditioning other people, I'm pretty sure. And so...
Did you know why they were getting rid of the old drummer?
I don't know.
Do you want to get into that?
I don't really know. It might have been the musical differences. But basically, so they flip-flopped on the first audition, the second audition. They weren't sure still. And they were like, well, this is the tiebreaker, the third audition. We got a gig in Washington, D.C. at the Velvet Lounge. We got to leave this weekend. Can you do it? And I'm like, yeah, sure. And I said to myself, well, I think I definitely have this gig because playing live is one of my fortes. And so that was it. So I got the gig after that audition gig in Washington, D.C. The third audition was a live gig.
Did you feel like, you know, Hal and John were someone you guys could get along with? Because
you know,
how bands are.
Yeah, man. Well, you know, it's like that with every band. Every band is like a relationship, and there's always give and take and push and pull. And, you know, like any great family, you have a disorder.
Well, it turned out to be a fantastic combination. Because
that's what I love about this guy. If he wants to do something, he's going to do it. Bop, bop! Toes. And you couldn't take it to little behind.
That chemistry right off, or was it something
I thought I felt it, and I thought musically we fit together well. You know, that's where the chemistry starts. When you all vibe musically, then you really start to go to another level. I think that we each pushed each other to be better than we were, and I think John and Hal's songs were special, and I was glad to be a part of that, you know, and wanted to make music with them, and I got to make a lot of great music with them.
So what happened after that? I mean, did you, that DC show, did you stay at DC for a while?
Well, actually, I want to go back before.
Go ahead.
This is an important story for everyone who's in a band. I was in a band, Bobby Shenard was alive, he was my mentor. He would take me to his gigs. I would roadie for him. We spent so much time together. He gave so much good advice. And I was in a band where the guys in the band really loved me. We'd go back since high school. A band called the Vaudevillains. The Vaudevillains were a Long Island band. We did covers, we did originals, and we did some comedy music. Because these guys loved me so much, and I was into Dr. Demento and Weird Al and Frank Zappa and stuff. So they were like, yo, we're going to let you do some of your comedy songs. So I said, all right, man, I got a song. It's called My Asshole's Burning.
My asshole's burning. My asshole's burning for you. My asshole's burning. My asshole's burning for you.
And basically, they were like, oh, yeah, we'll let you sing. They thought it was a big joke, you know. It was all right, let him do his little song. And this fucking song killed it at the show. That these fucking guys had to do this fucking song. Every fucking show we did, the audience wanted to hear this fucking song. That they were like, oh, my God, where do we start?
Since my mama made the hot rod show, my best friend is the toilet bowl. Now the paper gotta get a roll. Why am I burning asshole? My asshole's burning, burning, baby. My asshole's burning for you. It's burning, I tell you, fuck. My asshole's burning, I'm burning, baby. My asshole's burning for you. Burning for you, burning, it's true. Burning to you.
And it was something that was very special to me. No one had ever let me sing before, even though the drummer always wants to sing. And they let me do my comedy music, and it was something very special. And so, when that band broke up, this is the point of the story. When that band broke up in 97, at 98, 90, anyway.
You were what, 25 years old?
Yeah, I went to fucking Bobby Shinnard. I was like, Bobby, my fucking band, my mother left me and now my fucking band broke up. What the fuck am I going to do? And he said, yo, don't worry, man. There's going to be other bands. I said, no, you don't understand. There will never be another band that lets me sing My Asshole's Burning. This is not going to happen. And he's like, no, there'll be other bands, bro. You got a fire in your eyes that those guys will never have. And I want you to just keep going, bro. Do not give up on this. You'll be other bands. And Bobby Shinnard was right. There was other bands, and that band was Banana Fish, and a lot, many others after that, many other great bands. I've been blessed to be a part of so many great bands, and Banana Fish is just one of them. But he was right. There was other bands, but I was right also that no one else will ever let me sing My Asshole's Burning again. So, you know what I'm saying?
Well, there are more bands for you in the future.
You know what I mean? But you were both right, is what my point was. I thought that was funny, you know what I mean, that happened like that, and then I got another band.
Yeah. religious like that.
Superstitious?
No, religious. Religious, superstitious, it's the same thing, man. Right?
I think so, yeah.
Hey, so you way Jesus you live came out your life, solo album?
Jesus? What's it called?
Hold on, can you tell me about it?
Thanks, you can change it now.
Alright,
you can change it.
What's up, my
halitosis?
How you doing, buddy?
What's up, bro?
What's doing, man?
Oh, yeah, wait.
Alright! This is our main man, Chuck Coulon. That's a capital C for cool.
Cool.
Yeah. This is our DC abode. When we play in DC, I sleep around over here. So Chuck, what's going on tonight?
Well, we got the Orange, Holland's best but little known band. Oh, go all the way in tonight. It's 1-0, and they're opening up for 555 and Banana Fitzgerald.
All right, sounds like fun.
Yo, John, he's not upstairs.
86.
He went to the club without telling me.
What are you gonna have, Hal?
Your ass on a platter.
Oh, the real goods.
They got free coffee now.
What's your name and what's your job and why are you here?
My name's Eddie Wilchins. I play guitar for 555.
Yeah, baby.
Yeah.
You guys a folk band?
I'm a crooner. No, I'm a crooner. I do like Sinatra styles.
1831 14th Street, baby. Black cat. Oh, I like the smell of money. It's almost better than sex.
Everything, you know. They got the fucking,
you know,
limo. They got
black cat, black cat.
That's right.
On God.
How you feeling, man?
And then, yeah, Soap the Canyon.
Yeah.
Came out.
How do I look?
You look fabulous.
You just said
that one.
How you feeling about
are
this?
Are you leaving right after? I'm feeling...
Do I have a sore on my tongue?
Oh, dude, you got some wax?
Yeah, I got lots of wax. For you, dude?
Wax for you.
Happening.
I
want to hear
the
testimony
about this. You know, cannot stand out here and pick up beautiful girls.
You got to have bread for that.
That's right. That's right.
You got to have bread for that.
Straight from New York City, please welcome Banana Fistula.
I think my head is going to explode.
One more floor on the floor. One less good done. Me a lot better. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Well, I'm on fire.
for Zero seems like a good name to me because you got your fruit, your animal, and your number.
We like a lot!
I dig profanity.
Bang, 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 cocking trigger, cocking trigger. I'm your white cracker whipping boy. Yeah. Hey, 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 little sister, I hear you looking for a bigger toy.
What are you gonna have, Hal?
Your ass on a platter.
Myself, I would like to say the Banana Fish Zero was one of those unique combinations in history and time. Its synchronicity comes together where three guys with the right talent and the right mindset put on a really good fucking band. Yeah. And you guys kicked ass.
Yeah, well,
I mean, you really did. That's and I just wanted, you know,
chemistry is
did you feel that chemistry right off, or was it something
I thought I felt it, and I thought musically we fit together well. You know, that's where the chemistry starts. When you all vibe musically, then you really start to go to another level. I think that we each pushed each other to be better than we were. And I think John and Hal's songs were special. And I was glad to be a part of that, you know, and wanted to make music with them. And I got to make a lot of great music with them.
And I met this band the first time in 2004. I saw you, I just couldn't fucking believe how good you guys were. And I remember you did a show at the Continental. And it was like one of those four band nights. And then, before you guys hit the stage, the place was wall-to-wall people. Wall-to-wall people. Yeah, this is like 2005, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
Wall-to-wall people. And then, After you guys left the stage, half hour later, fucking empty again. Empty.
There was nothing left.
It was like, you know, I was like, wow. That's what really blew me away about you guys. And that's an impact you have on a venue. That's my experience with Banana Fish Cereal. Besides the fact, they're just probably one of the most rockin'est, great, like, club bands you could ever go see. If you want a band that's just, you know, hard, good rock and roll, stomping, punk rock style, Banana Fish Zero is fucking it.
Yeah.
Oh, the real goods.
They got free coffee now.
No money, no honey.
How you doing, my brother?
Very good, man. You know how all this wind is being generated by low front clashing with a high front. So we better drive faster towards Boston because we're gonna have to fight that wind.
You want to say anything to posterity?
I love you, posterity. I was making love to posterity in my dreams last night.